Hello aspirants, looking at current affairs for 27 September, the news items picked up from the Hindu newspaper are these 9. We'll look at them in detail. The first one, all help but no troops to Afghanistan. So this in the context of US Defense Secretary who is on a visit to India. We have seen that US is putting pressure on India to send its soldiers to Afghanistan, but India has made it clear that there shall be no boots from India on the ground. So, we will not be sending our soldiers, we will be providing assistance to Afghanistan. We have already extended $3 billion aid to Afghanistan. We are providing security assistance in the form of training to the soldiers and police forces also of Afghanistan. Plus, also we have supplied some utility and attack helicopters. However, Afghanistan has been repeatedly seeking more lethal weapons and ammunition from India, but we have been a little reluctant on this aspect. Other aspect in India-US relations which were discussed with the Defense Secretary were regarding Chinese presence. In the context of Chinese presence in Southeast Asia, India's vital role in this region was upheld. Plus also both sides supported freedom of navigation, overflight and unimpeded lawful commerce in the Indian Ocean and the broader Asia-Pacific region. So this aspect was reiterated. Also the recently held Malabar trilateral naval exercise also was appreciated and spoke about how synergies between the navies were operationalized. So this is a trilateral naval exercise. You should know about it. We have discussed it. It took place recently. It is amongst three nations, navies of three nations, India, Japan and US. Earlier it was India-US naval exercise. Now Japan has also been roped in. So it's a trilateral naval exercise held annually. Then next is 149 Indians in Sharjah jails freed under general amnesty. So, in Sharjah, the Sheikh Sultan bin Muhammad Al Qasimi, he was on a visit to India and here he has announced that 149 Indians, including Keralites, who have been jailed as such in Sharjah, who have completed 3 years of incarceration of jail and who do not have any criminal case registered against them, would be set free under a general amnesty scheme. So this would be there. Also, they will not be made to go back to the country, home country, but they will be given good jobs in UAE itself. So this has also been assured that they would be rehabilitated as well. So this is the announcement coming forth. So here you can see the details that as of mid-July, around 7,448 Indian nationals are lodged in foreign jails in 81 countries. So here they are also accused of petty crimes related to financial matters, or some petty cases are also against them. So here you can see Saudi Arabia has the maximum number of Indians as prisoners. Then comes UAE. So this, due to privacy laws, USA, Canada, Australia, many European countries don't share their prisoner information. Since we don't have that information available, the data is not available. So as you look at the figures, here you can see that Saudi Arabia and UAE hold 46% of all prisoners. Then next is, center will release 2,800 crore for Polavaram, says Naidu. So the Andhra Pradesh Chief Minister, Mr. Chandrababu Naidu, has stated that central government has agreed to release money to the tune of rupees 2,800 crore for the Polavaram project. You should know, we have discussed this project quite often, so you should be aware of this project. We'll look at it once again too. It is pegged at rupees 54,000 crore. The project cost is this much. Revised estimates as such, and it has also been announced, declared as a national project now, and the central government has agreed to release funds for it. Even the state government of Andhra Pradesh wants the central government to assist it in its bridging its revenue deficit of 16,000 crores. So some assistance here has also been sought. So this you can see other assistance have also been sought. This is in the context of the bifurcation act, Andhra Pradesh Reorganization Act. After Andhra Pradesh was bifurcated and Telangana was formed as a new state, the assistance which the government has to provide for has been assured. So especially this Polavaram project is one of them. So the center has agreed to fund the entire project cost incurred after April 1, 2014. So here you can see this, the project is detailed out here. So this is the Polavaram Canal project. So you can see the Krishna and Godavari River. So the Godavari River here, this canal project will be linking the two rivers. It's called Pattisima is the region here. So Pattisima, a lift irrigation project, it interlinks Godavari and Krishna River through this Polavaram canal. So here you can see Once the Polavaram dam is completed, the right canal will also be linked to the dam. So it's been revised as a national river interlinking project. So what is good about this? That it will be beneficial to the farmers here in Krishna River. Godavari is the surplus river, so you can see the flow. So the linking could provide flow of water from Godavari into towards Krishna. So this will help in the farmers in the Krishna River basin, Krishna Delta, to be benefited by irrigation facilities. So some concerns which are there is that it is harmful to the environment. It may affect the aquatic life as such, and the water table may also be lift up abnormally. It may cause damage and flooding in some areas. So those are also concerns as such. And farmers in West Godavari fear that inflow into Godavari Delta system will get reduced if water is diverted to Krishna. So those aspects are also there. Then the next news item is Tripura government approves SIT to probe journalist Shantanu Bhaumik's death. So this recent case of 22-year-old journalist Shantanu Bhaumik, who was abducted and killed on 20th September in Tripura. So here he was. He is working with a local television channel. He was working with a local television channel and he was covering a clash between the indigenous People's Front of Tripura, IPFT, and Tripura Rajya Upajati Ganmukti Parishad, which is a tribal wing of CPM. So here he was hit from behind, abducted, and later found with serious stab injuries. He was taken to hospital but declared brought dead. So he has here, this incident has resulted in furor, a journalist killed. So we have seen earlier such cases as well. So now another case, Gauri Lankesh was the previous case which had made news. Now this is another case of a journalist being killed. So this, in this context, Tripura cabinet has decided to form a special investigation team to probe into this killing, and also a compensation of rupees 10 lakh would be given to the family of the slain journalist. This is also another horror, a journalist being killed. Then next is sale of tobacco only through licensed shops. So the health ministry has now announced a regulation on sale, in which it is asking all the state governments to develop a mechanism through the municipal authorities so that only those retail outlets which have permission and authorization can sell tobacco products. And shops which are authorized to sell tobacco products will not be permitted to sell any non-tobacco product. Like, you know, you see that tobacco products are sold along with other products like tea, coffee, biscuits, chips, etc. So non-tobacco users also, especially children, also go up to these shops. So that is why this is a regulation, this is a proposal, a regulation on the sale which has been proposed by the Home Ministry, Health Ministry, Central Health Ministry, which state governments and municipal authorities have to put into effect. So under the COPTA Act, Cigarettes and Other Tobacco Products Act of 2003, sale of tobacco products to minors is completely prohibited. Still, we see that actually tobacco industry targets youth and children as its new customer base. So that is why there is a need to regulate this, and this is a step taken in that direction. That there'll be, just like liquor sale, there are authorized shops which sell only liquor. There'll be authorized shops which will be selling only tobacco products. They cannot be allowed to sell any other product. So this is there. So here the major provisions of COPTA also mentioned. COTPA. So here you can see prohibition on smoking in public places is one provision. Then there is prohibition on advertisement, sponsorship, and promotion of tobacco products. There's prohibition of sale of tobacco products to minors. Even sale within 100 meter radius of educational institutions is not allowed. Then there is display of pictorial health warning on tobacco products made mandatory. Also, regulation on tar and nicotine content of tobacco products is in effect. So this is there. Then next is BSF pushes back Rohingya from Tripura. So the Home Ministry has instructed BSF recently, and on its instructions, BSF has pushed back 4 Rohingya Muslims who were trying to cross the unfenced stretch of Bangladesh border in Tripura. So this has come into news. This is the first instance of Rohingyas being pushed back after the August 19 circular, in which the Home Ministry said that all Rohingya Muslims should be identified and deported. When the question was asked how Rohingyas are identified, it is said by a BSF official on condition of anonymity that the Bengali dialect they speak is different from that spoken in India and Bangladesh. So they can be easily identified. So this is the action taken. So BSF has identified 75 vulnerable locations on the 21-kilometer stretch in Tripura here on the border, and Rohingyas are now being pushed back. Even we have already seen earlier, Assam and Manipur governments had also asked state police and BSF to push back any Rohingya attempting to enter into the country. So as we have seen, the Home Ministry has also set up a committee to examine various methods to curb the misuse of free movement along the Myanmar border also. So along the Myanmar border also, curbs are being imposed, as well as along the Bangladesh border, from where Rohingya Muslims are migrating into India as well. So here you can see, this is the Rakhine state of Rohingya Muslims in Myanmar. From here they are entering into Cox's Bazar in Bangladesh, and from Bangladesh they enter into India. You can see West Bengal, Tripura, Mizoram and Manipur are the states where they reach. Then next is, center backs local cyber security tech. So the central government wants to promote domestic technology and also wants to prevent data theft by foreign entities. So that is why it has announced a policy that preference would be given to domestically manufactured and produced cybersecurity products in all official procurements under the Made in India scheme. So this has been announced by MeitY, Ministry of Electronics and Information Technology. So there are almost 70 categories of cybersecurity products which have been identified. So here, Indian companies, it is expected they can be taken to task too if they breach any Indian law as such, and also the probability that they will act against the sovereignty of the country is very low. So foreign players, they can be a backdoor to data from the country going into the hand of any foreign country. So that is why we want to encourage domestic technology through this policy. So Made in India would also be promoted. So local supplier as such is also defined as a company which is incorporated and registered in India, and the revenue from the product or from any intellectual property license should also accrue to that company only. So that will be a local supplier which will be given preference. Then next is, committee to review policy hurdles, Suresh Prabhu. So here the central government has now announced that to fast track decisions on domestic and foreign investment proposals in coordination with state governments and even the central government's investment facilitation and promotion arm, which is the Invest India, steps are being taken. A regulatory review committee will be set up, which will look into the policy related roadblocks and other factors which are inhibiting the industrial growth in the country and impacting the ease of doing business. So that is why steps would be taken for this. Also, underutilization in industry is also being targeted. There is said to be around 26% unutilized capacity. So this will be taken care of through increasing domestic demand as well as boosting exports, so that entire capacity of industries can also be utilized. So that will give a boost to industrial growth. Also, there are some demands by CII, Confederation of Indian Industries. So here, some demands which have been put forth are that it calls for relaxation of fiscal consolidation targets for a year or two. Means public investment, government investment should increase, public spending to boost construction is being proposed. Then also it says that more time should be given to micro, small and medium enterprises to comply with GST regime. Also under GST, other commodities like oil, gas, alcohol and real estate and electricity should be brought in GST regime is also a proposal which it has put forth. Also it wants simplification of input tax credit norms. So here we are seeing the input tax credit has been a bane, especially for the exporters. So this is also, simplification is also demanded. Plus also for employment, it says that reinstatement of fixed term employment for all manufacturing sectors should be brought in, and a stable coordinated policy regime transitions with adequate lead times and certainty is essential, because continuously changing rules and regulations also affect the industry. Then next is the last news item. Government forms committee for 5G rollout by 2020. So central government has established a support fund of about 500 crores to facilitate research and development for 5G, and government is keen to be part of the bodies which set up standards for 5G across the world. So India did not participate in this process during 3G and 4G, but now for 5G technologies, when the standards are being finalized, the international authority which is finalizing the standards is International Telecommunication Union, ITU. So here Indian participation in this process is also sought, and for that a forum has been formed comprising of secretaries of the ministries of communication, IT, science and technology, and even representatives from industry and academia, so that India can also participate in this process of defining global standards for the next generation of wireless technology, that is 5G technology. So 5G technology is aims to deliver up to 10 Gbps, 10 gigabits per second in urban areas and 1 Gbps in rural areas. So this is there. Also, India needs to strengthen its domestic telecommunication equipment manufacturing too. So steps would be taken in that direction as well. So even aim is that local manufacturers should be enabled to capture 50% of Indian market and 10% of global market in next 5 to 7 years. So that is the aim. So 5G 2020 forum will also be formed. So this you can see are the technologies, telecommunication technologies. 1G, which came in the 1980s, was at the speed of 2 Kbps. It was providing basic voice services using analog protocols. So cordless phones, as you can see. Then 2G technology, which came, was primarily voice using digital standards. This was analog. Now came the digital GSM, CDMA technology. Then 3G came in the 21st century, where first mobile broadband utilizing IP protocols came in. Then 4G brought in higher speed of 100 Mbps and true mobile broadband on a unified standard LTE. So this is there. Then now 5G technology, which will come in, will provide speed up to 20 Gbps. It's expected to come in by 2020, which will provide tactile internet with service aware devices and fiber like speed. So here some of the applications of 5G are mentioned, like cloud based systems, we'll be able to stream software, updates, music, navigation data, traffic conditions, even to driverless cars. Download time of even HD full length movies will be in seconds. Also, 5G speed has the potential for simultaneous language translations between people during a teleconference. So such are the potential uses of 5G technology here. So these are the news items. Thank you.